it kind of clicked to me a little bit late why the machine had cleared more material at the back than the front when I was trying to initially kind of reduce the bump from the water damage. And it's I feel like an idiot, but at the same time it was kind of worth it because I got to route out the branding on the machine. That was really satisfying actually. So it's very simple. If I kind of move my hands around where the maker end slide is and feel the edge, it's quite flush because the bar and the end slide plate were sitting on the table. On the other end, it's a little bit different. So that I could feel it's actually dropped down at least a mil, and that explains that initial problem. So what I'm going to do now is actually reduce. I'm going to unscrew all of these and just allow it to drop down as far as it can, and then I'm going to do another pass on the bed just to clear it up again. I was also talking to Nathan again from Opentronics about this issue I had where the path almost went from the start of one line directly to the start of another line. It actually increased speed, so I'm glad I was in the room at the right time just to be able to record this, because I've never seen that happen before, and it was quite spooky in a bizarre way. It's almost like a poltergeist had sort of got into the machine, and obviously I don't believe in this shit, but you know what I mean. It's you could go about describing this in some very unusual ways, but in reality, it seems that that is a cause of electrical interference. And if I look at the setup I have, I've just cleared this up a little bit. You know, I've got my two power cables coming in, AC and DC. And then my USB cable was initially just going along these two cables. And it seems to be the case that if you have a spike in the electrics, if there's a surge, that can interfere with the signal being sent through the USB cable. And I thought the G code was sent directly to the shield, and that kind of done its thing. I could then take my computer off and bugger off. But actually, that's not the case. It sends small sections because the RAM or the memory on the G shield isn't that great, and it's constantly updating that. So you can't, you know, an error can happen at some point when the buffer is reached and it has to be refreshed and new data sent. So that's a new kind of thing that I wasn't aware about. In any case, I'm just going to get on with this and hopefully not pass out because I need to eat something as well.
So I began by loosening the machine screws holding the maker slide end plates, pushing everything down and tightening them. I then measured the space between the y-axis, which was 947 mm at the front of the machine and 949 at the rear. I used a piece of timber, which I cut at 948, as a spacer and loosened the self-tapping screws to push the maker slides a little apart. At the rear of the machine, I used a sash clamp after loosening both the machine and self-tapping screws to bring them in line with the measuring stick. I thought I had rolled the gantry between these two points when assembling the machine, assuming this would keep the spacing consistent, but I have done so many little modifications that I am now not sure what I've done. In any case, I'm going to carry on with realigning this machine, and currently I'm checking that the X and Y axis are at 90 degrees of one another, as well as the two maker slides being parallel. Once this was done, I also checked the angle between the gantry and the table, which was expectedly quite off. I set the program to run an area clear and began cutting 0.4 of a millimeter into the center of the board.
I'm gonna pop through the shafts. I'm gonna leave this running. It cuts itself in half.
After that had completed, I changed the path from within the square to along the vector line to clear the edge. You can see during this pass the machine goes from along the x-axis into the y quite sharply, and the cutter head bounces a little. More sophisticated software will have a failsafe written into the firmware which slightly alters the feed rate when making risky passes. There's a lot of aspects of this machine that still feel quite problematic. I don't expect this to be flat since what happened in the last video. I'm just stubbornly persisting. Having this recess on the wasteboard will also restrict the overall size of material I can place onto the bed. I painted the top again with wet rot hardener and checked just the angles on the gantry against the bed, and they seemed a lot better. Along the x-axis was great. There was a slight gap along the top of the y-axis. You can't see it too well in this shot, but you're talking possibly 0.2 of a mil along the top of that bit. I was going to leave this video where it is, but that would suggest something went right, which isn't the case with this machine. I am waiting for an engineer's straight edge to come in the post to check the bed against. In the meantime, I'm also going to test whether the cutting head is interfering with the stepper motors. I'm going to do this by attaching a pen and disconnecting the power to the spindle. I will then draw what would otherwise be cut lines on and off the vector path to see if any strange things happen. I will be using the SVG file I created for the extended maker end plate to test the path accuracy. After setting the pen height, the drawing seemed to follow on path with the vector correctly. I then changed the tool path to follow within the circle and to the outside of the larger form, making sure the tool diameter was set to the same size as the nib, around 0.8 mm. You can see a smaller circle within the original, but there's no difference to the larger shape. Instead, it drew the line on path despite being set on the outside. I then swapped the paths around in the software and tried again. Circles formed around the original illustrations of the vectors, but the path for the end plate maintained its position on path.
I don't understand why this pattern here hasn't replicated on the outside despite having changed the cutting path.
This seems to be a problem with the SVG file, but the software is aware of the inside and outside of the paths, as illustrated by the shadow change in the software when changing that setting. Therefore, I suspect it is the software.
What I also want to do is reconnect the spindle and have that running while I'm doing the same file to see what happens. Essentially, what I have here is a very inaccurate drawing machine.
I'm going to draw a square that is 60 by 60 millimeters in theory. I set the bit diameter to 4 millimeters and drew on the path. And then within the path, and then outside the path. I wired up the spindle and again drew on the inside of the path, the outside of the path, and up the garden path. Yeah, it was, wasn't it? If you found this video interesting, be sure to click on the information card at the top right corner of the screen, where you'll find links to relevant playlists and my other channel. In next week's video, I will build a pen holder for the CNC machine.